No shame, no shame, no shame, no shame, no shame. There is no shame. Guys, listen, you played a basketball game the other day. You played one-on-one with another player, and you're good. Everybody knows you're good. You're probably one of the better players on the boys' varsity basketball team. One-on-one, you never lose. But today you lost. And not only did you lose, you lost to a girl. And not only was it a girl, it was a girl that is presently on the JV girls basketball team. And all your boys are standing around and you lost. You are ashamed. Ladies, ever since you were in elementary school, ever since you knew what a body was, you have, as much as you have tried not to, you have been comparing your body to others. And when you look at your body compared to theirs, you are ashamed. And not only that, there are so many other things that at this time in history bring us shame. Maybe it is the type of clothing you wear. Maybe it's not name brand and you're ashamed. Maybe it's the type of shoes you have. You don't have the name brand sneakers and you are ashamed. Maybe it's the house you live in or the neighborhood you came from. You're ashamed. Maybe you ride the school bus and all your other friends' parents bring them and they're in carpool. You're ashamed. Or maybe you ride the short bus and you're really ashamed. Maybe you're in a low-level class or even a high-level class because it's still not real cool, right, to be smart in school. A lot of people are ashamed of even that. There are so many things that bring us shame. And what about being at school during lunchtime and saying your grace in front of your friends? You are ashamed. Maybe it's sharing the gospel or even letting people know you're a Christian and talking about all that Jesus stuff, all that foolishness. Yep, I said it, foolishness. I mean, think about it. God came down from heaven to earth, lived as a human, suffered, died on the cross, was resurrected, walked around the earth for 40 days and then went back to heaven and sitting on a throne and he is interceding for you and for me. Who believes that? For a lot of people, that's foolishness, right? Yeah, for some. And to be able to share that with other people with all that's going on around us is hard for many, absolutely. But here is the deal. Because there are so many other things we can talk about, because we can talk about the latest sports, or we can talk about the level we're at on a video game, or we can talk about the latest fashions and trends, projects that are due, events that are gonna be happening at school. We can talk about all these other things with our friends, but when it comes to talking about them, talking to them about the gospel, we struggle. We have a bit of a problem. It turns out today that more and more and more, we have a problem in this time and culture talking about the good news and learning about what the good news is. We have other philosophies. We have other teachings. There are other things that make more sense to us. Rather than learning about the good news and the gospel, we would rather learn about good times and how to get ahead. We listen to things that are coming up today, new things we think that are new about how we can do better in life. The only thing is, things have not gotten better. Things have not changed a whole lot. The minute you think things have gotten better and have changed, you discover they haven't changed at all. If we were to take a look in the book of Romans, which we're going to do today, if you look in the book of Romans, things are much like they are today. There were people that were about pleasure. They were about getting ahead. They were about materialism. They were about money. They were about jobs and careers and being the best they thought they could be without having to hear anything about Jesus and anything about the gospel, the good news. They were like us. They weren't looking for good news. They were looking for good times and for getting ahead. Things have not changed a lot. But as we look at Romans chapter 1 and we look at Paul, and actually the entire book talks about the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul talks about the gospel. And in chapter 1, verse 16 and 17, we hear Paul say these words, "For I am not ashamed of the good news about Christ. It is the power of God at work, saving everyone who believes, the Jew first and also the Gentile. This good news tells us how God makes us right in His sight. This is accomplished from start to finish by faith. As the scriptures say, it is through faith that a righteous person has life." Paul is so not ashamed. He is not ashamed of the gospel. He is not ashamed of the good news. Paul has found some things that work, and he's not ashamed. So the big question today, the big question for us that maybe we should ask is, why wasn't Paul afraid or ashamed to share the gospel? Why was he not ashamed? Why did it not bring him shame? I'm sure, as I've said, it sounded just as foolish back then as it does to us today. Time has not changed anything. We're still looking for other ways to get ahead and to do better other than the gospel message, other than the good news. So the big question, why was Paul not ashamed? Well, here's the answer. Paul found something that worked for him. Paul found something that brought him through very difficult times. If you look at the book of Romans and some of the other New Testament books he wrote, he talks about all types of things that he went through, all types of threats. He talks about whippings and beatings and being put in jail and being almost stoned to death. He goes through all this stuff. And he finds that the gospel works. And so he's not ashamed to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ everywhere, every day, every time he gets an opportunity. He is not ashamed. And so the question becomes, what about us? Have we tried the gospel? Have we given it a chance? Have we studied it and believe it to the point that we see that it works? Or are we out there chasing after other messages, other philosophies, other things that maybe help us get ahead? I would like to challenge you and myself as well today to go and return to the gospel. Go back and look at that message, that promise. Paul says it is the power of God to salvation. You want to be saved? And you know, even that term, we'll talk about it a little bit more later, is thrown around. What are we being saved from? What does salvation mean? Paul says it is the power of God to save. It is the one thing that will change your life, not just for a moment, not just for today, but it will change your life for a lifetime. We want to be with God. We want to be like God. We want to have faith in God. And of course, we don't want to be ashamed. So as we look at returning to the gospel, let's delve into the gospel message a little bit more and find out exactly what Paul meant when he talked about it being the power to save. I hope you'll give it some thought. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for Paul's writings. Thank you for his message, his words, his teaching. Help us, God, to understand what he experienced, what he meant. But most of all, help us to understand the good news, the message that Jesus Christ preached himself about you, your love for us, your grace, and your power to save and transform our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.